Next, we'll place the free end of the column in a small vial of hexane or water or some suitable solvent. And what we're looking for is a steady stream of bubbles. If the bubbles aren't seen, we need to check the carrier gas supply, flow controllers, etc., for proper settings and for leaks. As long as we've got those bubbles, we're fine. Now we'll wipe off any residual solvent using our lab wipe. For our carrier gas, we want to use high purity hydrogen or helium. Nitrogen was once popular, but for most applications, it's not recommended anymore. Whatever carrier gas you use, a purity of 99.995% or better is recommended. Again, the most important impurity is oxygen, and it must be avoided. You want less than 1 ppm of oxygen in your gas, or you'll damage your column when it gets hot. Now we're ready to install the column into the detector, and we'll follow the same process just as we did for the inlet. We've already got our septa, our nut, and our ferrule on. We've made a clean cut, and we're just going to put it in there, get it nice and snug. We should also inspect for leaks. We can use an electronic leak detector to do this. We'll look at both fittings, both the inlet and the detector. Electronic pressure control allows direct entry of carrier gas linear velocity or flow rate. It's critical that the correct column dimensions are entered into the PC software or via the GC keypad for accurate velocity or flow values to be set. Always consult the column performance summary sheet that accompanies the column for accurate inner diameter information. This is when the test mix or one of your standard comes in handy to verify the settings. We should have something of known retention in the mix to make sure that all our settings are correct. And of course, we're looking for good peak shapes to confirm good installation. We can also verify carrier gas velocity by injecting a non-retained compound. We'll start with our oven at about 35 to 40 degrees Celsius. Now we're going to inject 1 to 2 microliters of a non-retained compound with the split-splitless inlet mode in the split mode. Now if you're using Megaboard Direct or Coulon Column or even splitless, dilute the non-retained compound a little bit so the sample won't saturate the detector. Now most people use methane here, but a good trick that you see people use all over the place is they use a butane lighter. It's easily accessible and all we need is a little bit of gas. Make sure you don't light the lighter, but pull up a microliter or two of that gas and then just rapidly inject it, start the GC, and look for a very sharp symmetrical peak. Now a small amount of peak tailing might be observed with splitless injection. If no peak appears, there may not be any carrier gas flow. Check the regulators, the gas supply, flow controllers for the proper settings, and make sure that the detector, the recorder, the syringe are all functioning properly. If the non-retained compound is tailing, there may be a leak in the inlet, or we may have poor column installation, or an excessively low split ratio. Reinstall the column, check the settings, and check the inlet for leaks. A non-tailing peak is required before we continue. Now, let's condition the column. Heating a column without flow or while oxygen is present in the carrier gas stream will ruin the column. First, make sure that all the oxygen's been purged from your column. Letting the column purge with carrier gas for 15 minutes is usually sufficient. Heat the column to its upper temperature limit or a temperature 10 to 20 degrees above the highest operating temperature of the method, whichever's lower. Don't exceed the column upper limit or the column damage will result. The rate of heating is not critical, but being oxygen and leak free is. Observe the baseline as you do the conditioning procedure. You may see some artifacts, peaks, from the installation process, but they shouldn't be persistent. After the column has reached the conditioning temperature, observe the baseline. If it continues to rise as you hold temperature, you may want to check for leaks. If it rises, then falls, you may have just eluded some higher molecular weight contamination that was transferred to the column as you installed it. A flat baseline is what you're after. You should be able to get that in a reasonable time, depending on the state of the instrument when the column was installed. You could be ready as little as 15 minutes, or it could take more than an hour after reaching the conditioning temperature. If the baseline doesn't stable after 2 or 3 hours and does not remain constant, stop the conditioning process. An unstable baseline can be caused by a leak in the carrier line or inlet area, or by system contamination. You're probably better off to cool it down and fix the problem before continuing. Polar stationary phases and thick films usually require longer times to stabilize than non-polar phases and thinner films. Plot columns, porous layer open tubular columns, require special conditioning procedures. Refer to the column information sheet for the appropriate procedure. Now, when it comes to ECDs and MSDs, some believe these detectors may stabilize faster if the column's not connected to the detector during column conditioning. The problem with doing that is you won't know if you do have an unstable baseline or a leak, and if you condition the column with a leak, you'll cause irreparable damage to the column, giving it a high bleed or making it active. If the column is conditioned with the detector and disconnected, I'd recommend you remove a small portion of the column end as it may be damaged. Remove 10 to 20 centimeters of the exposed column end before connecting the column to the detector. For capillary columns, the average linear velocity is a better and more meaningful measure of the carrier gas than volumetric flow rate. Velocity just talks about the speed of the gas, and so we don't need to know the volume of the column or what diameter we're using. Since the gas viscosity changes with temperature, you need different pressures at different temperatures to obtain the same carrier gas average linear velocity. Therefore, always set the carrier gas average linear velocity at the same temperature for a given analysis, and often this is the initial oven temperature. Now, if you want, you can eject 1 to 2 microliters of the appropriate non-retained compound and calculate the linear velocity, as we showed, using the retention time of that peak in the equation that we're showing now. Adjust the column head pressure until the desired average velocity is obtained. For GCs with EPC, the linear velocity can be entered into the PC or the GC keypad. The correct dimensions must be entered, as we stated earlier. Refer to the dimensions listed on the column performance summary sheet, as we mentioned earlier, to get the most accurate information. Now, length can be estimated by counting the loops on the column cage and multiplying by 0.54 meters for a standard cage or 0.4 meters for a 5-inch cage. Contact Agilent Technical Support for additional information. It's always a good idea to see what your system looks like with no sample or a blank run. This can be valuable for troubleshooting later if a problem arises. After the column is conditioned, go ahead and run a blank run. You can use your standard temperature program or the following. Start at 40 to 50, ramp 10 to 20 degrees per minute up to whatever your high temperature is, 300 degrees, and hold at that temperature for 10 to 15 minutes. Save this background trace for future comparisons. It could come in handy for troubleshooting, as I said earlier. There should be no peaks in the blank chromatogram. Peaks indicate a contamination problem prior to the column, usually in the inlet area or even before that. As a column degrades with normal usage, the magnitude of the baseline rise will increase. If a baseline rise occurs at a much lower temperature than previously obtained, the column and/or the GC is most likely contaminated or perhaps damaged. Well, now you're ready to begin operating as usual.